And you're on.
All right, thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this Marion City Council work session for Tuesday, September 30th at about 1:10 p.m. First thing on the agenda is report of the closed session. Prior to the step of session, we had a closed session. Topics of discussion were legal and contractual matters. Persons present were Mayor Rick Meehan, City Manager David Recor, Council President Lloyd Martin, Council Secretary Mary Knight, Council Members Doug Simic, Margaret Pillis, Brent Ashley, Dennis Dare, and Joe Matresic. We also joined by legal counsel Heather Stansberry and Executive Office Associate Diane Chavis. There was a motion made by Council Member Matresic and seconded by Council Member Ashley to close the meeting. The vote was unanimous. Next on the agenda is comments from the public. Is any person who may wish to speak on a topic the work session agenda may speak for a total of 3 minutes, and they need to state their name and address and the subject in which they wish to speak. Anyone in the audience? Yes, sir.
John Medlin, 60th Street.
Welcome,
I wish
John.
To speak on item 5B, which is the report on behavior in June. Normally, I would have raised my questions at the police commission meeting, but my understanding was that there wasn't going to be a police commission meeting in September. But then in the cover letter for this item, the cover letter from the city manager, he said it was discussed at the September 4th police commission meeting. Anyway, I'll raise my question now, and that is concerning the noise, the 123 noise complaints. How many of those noise complaints dealt with residential rental units? Of those, how many of those initiated a call to the people that are listed on the rental license to be notified when there's a problem? And my final question is, of those residential rental complaints, how many of those were referred to the noise board?
All right, thank you, John. We'll try to get those answers back to you as soon as we can.
Oh, I did email those questions to the police chief.
Okay, you did. Okay, thank you. All right, anyone else in the audience would like to speak? See none? Move on. Next is a new business. It's bid openings. Council Secretary Knight, will you help me? And City Manager David? The first one is for airport tree removal. Is Jamie here or Hal? Dean, how are you? Didn't know who to call on.
Yeah.
You got the airport too, do you?
Everywhere.
Yeah, there you go. All right.
There is a bid bond.
There is, okay. Mr. President, it looks like there are two bids.
Okay, thank you.
The first one is from Dyer and Cotman Tree Experts in Quantico, Maryland. There is a bid bond. The total is $28,700. There's none. Ooh. The next one is from SVF, and there's no address, there is no bid bond, and their total is $96,000.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Simon.
I'd like to make a motion that we recognize the apparent low bidder of Dyer Environmental Services for $28,700 and remand to staff for review and comment.
Okay. Got a motion by Councilmember Simic. Councilmember Ashley?
Second.
I have a second by Councilmember Ashley. Discussion? Councilmember Pills?
Yes. What was the allocation, the budget allocation for this?
$60,000.
Wow. So there's a real difference here.
Mm-hmm.
The low bidder seems to be low compared to the way we're looking at it.
I think he's on the mark.
You think he's on the mark?
Yeah, I think he's on the mark.
But the allocation is $60,000.
Yes, but also involved with those funds are also reseeding, replanting. So
Basically, this is just about where we wanted this to be, to help the Hill Road, because we also have...
Okay, I understand. Thank you.
That makes sense.
Thank you, Dean. All right, I got a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. All right, next on the agenda is Fire Headquarters Construction Management Services.
And yet, this is a combination of qualifications and price, so if you'll simply acknowledge the bidder and remand to staff for review, please.
Okay, good. The first one is GGI Builders, Inc., Gillis Gilkerson of Salisbury, Maryland. And the second one is Willow Construction out of Eastern Maryland, and those are all.
Okay. All right. Councilmember Simak?
Make a motion. We acknowledge the two bids from Gillis Gilkerson and Willow Construction, and remand to staff for review and comments.
All right. Councilmember Ashley?
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Ashley to acknowledge the bids and remand to staff for review. All those in favor? Voters unanimous. Thank you, Terry. All right. Next on the agenda is a sewer main inspection and sewer line cleaning. Dean?
Or that's the fire department one.
I think we have one more.
I thought I saw Hal's hand up there.
We should have one more construction management bid.
Do we have?
Yes.
From Harkins. Yeah, that was placed someplace different.
I'll amend the motion.
I'm
going to let Mary announce it.
City manager's fault, not mine.
Okay.
Okay. For the record, we have a third one from Harkins Contracting out of Salisbury, Maryland.
Thank you.
All right. Would you know?
This is for the fire headquarters.
Fire headquarters, yeah.
Yes.
Councilmember Simak?
Mr. President, I will amend my motion to include the three, which the third person would be Harkins Construction.
All right. Amendment is motion. Councilmember Ashley, will you amend?
Amendment
is second. Okay. All those in favor of that? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. All right. Who tripped you up there, David? All right. Next on the agenda is the sewer main inspection and sewer line cleaning.
There is a bid bond also required.
Okay. Thank you.
How many bids do we have there?
It looks like five, Mr. President.
Thank you.
There is a bid bond, and this is from USG, which is Utility Services Group, out of Camp Hill, Pennsylvania. As I mentioned, there is a bid bond. The total lump sum bid for items A1 through A5, is that correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Is $17,434.75. The next bid is from Video Pipe Services, Inc., out of Newfield, New Jersey. There is a bid bond. The total lump sum is $31,036.65. The next bid is from AM-Liner East, Inc., out of Berryville, Virginia. There is a bid bond. The total is $27,412.84. The next bid is submitted by Hydro Structures out of Arbutus, Maryland. There is a bid bond. The total is $26,842.25. The next bid is from Pipe Eye Server Sewer Services out of Bradford, Pennsylvania. There is a bid bond. The total is $33,398.48. And that's all, sir.
All right, okay. All right, Councilmember Simak?
Yes, I would motion that we recognize USG Underground Infrastructure, their bid of $17,434.75, and we remand those to staff for review and comment.
Okay. Councilmember Ashley?
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Ashley to accept the bids and remand to staff for review. Councilmember Dare?
What's comment? The staff estimate?
It comes out of the collection account. There was not specifically an amount set aside. We assumed it would be about $40,000 was what the estimate was.
Is there a reason why we couldn't include budget allowance or a staff estimate for any of the items when we're bidding them so we have a better feel for the bids received?
We can, as we have done in the past, I'll make sure I tell you beforehand. We stopped putting it on the sheet because we were getting bids the exact same price when we were posting on the website. So I will, from now on, when I sit down, I will tell you what that is.
Yeah. Very good.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. All right. Mr. Mayor.
I was going to ask the same question, Dennis, but that makes good sense, what they've just said. Dean, would you explain a little bit what this is for and what this does, and it's not all areas of town all at one time. It's in the areas that you find you're working on or need to have this performed.
Any street that Hal goes ahead and puts on his agenda to go ahead and repave, always film the sewers so I can do repairs prior to the paving being done so that hopefully we've got everything underneath the road all taken care of. We'll never have to go back in there again soon after it's been paved. Basically, when I do these repairs, where I'm setting ourselves up, especially for our AC pipe, to line it in the future. So once all this work is done, the lining contractor will just come in and line the sewer, and nothing has to be disturbed. So we try to film all these streets that prior to him paving.
Okay, and that was the question. I think that's the right way to do it, so we don't pave it. You come back 2 weeks later and dig it up.
Right.
You know, good job. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Dean. All right, next on the agenda is the post-June behavioral report presented by the police chief, Ross Pizarro. Ross, welcome.
Good afternoon, Mayor, Council. So in accordance with the strategic plan for Ocean City.
Make sure you're speaking to that microphone, Ross.
Yes, sir. I am proud to report the our June behavior, our plan, and our results, most of which are very, very positive in nature. We do have a PowerPoint that kind of illustrates this, and I can highlight certain points on it. The philosophy of the police department, not only throughout the year, but especially in June, strict enforcement, high visibility, and professionalism. The principles that we use to accomplish this are four basic principles that are very well known to us in law enforcement, and that is accurate and timely intelligence, looking at strategies in our deployment, the tactics that we're going to utilize, and we constantly assess and you know, make adjustments as needed to our plan that we have in place. What we saw throughout the month of June, and I can just go directly into it, certain categories that kind of that lead us to, as we move forward, that we believe we are going in the right direction in this plan that we put in place. was appropriate and deliberate in its nature. Disorderly code specifically, number one, we're showing, and we looked at a three-year average prior to 2014, which you'll see is a 19% decrease. And these are total calls for service strictly in the month of June. And I'd like to just highlight a couple more of these areas that show significant decreases in terms of previous years past. Malicious destruction of property down 39%. Report of a fight down 36%. Noise complaints being down 31%. And to just touch on a little bit more beyond the noise complaints, although I don't have all of the questions that you raised right at this point, but I can tell you of the 123 noise complaints, we did in fact write 21 reports. We know that 12 of those were residential in nature, and all of those were forwarded to the NORS board for review. Obviously, there's more questions to that we should be able to answer. I can tell you that when we look at noise complaints, 123 resulting in 21, so there's about 100 that were deemed unfounded. So what do we do with those? We don't do a lot of those. Once they're unfounded, we move on. Obviously, we have other calls for service, other issues to be dealing with, but that's something internally that we can take a look at. But generally speaking, when a call is unfounded, it is that, and it's the end of that call. What I can also tell you is that alcohol violations were down 30% this year as opposed to years past. And also rape and sex offenses were down as well. Across the board at the bottom, as you can see, there's a 14% decrease. In only one area, suspicious person or activity, we saw an increase. And Martha, if you would. Just the graphs just shows the decline and the total public disorderly calls for service in June. And on the previous slide, all of those areas in blue, that's the combination of those, and that's just kind of illustrates a reduction. If we can continue on the boardwalk, just calls isolated to the boardwalk, we are showing a drop off as well in 2014 as opposed to previous years. Some interesting facts for us, and we really take a look at these facts and figures, but what it's showing is six out of the 7 days of the week we're seeing a decrease in calls for service as opposed to years previous. Sunday, we're showing an increase. Why do we look at this? Because we want to look at our strategies and how we deploy and where the calls are coming from. Sunday, the higher calls versus previous years, we had lower calls. So that's kind of some of the reasoning why we take such a critical look at calls for service. If we can move on to the next, just as a bar graph that illustrates that, I'd like to move on to the UCR crime numbers. This is interesting. This is shows us right about the same as far as UCR crimes for the month of June for the town as a total. Not a lot of sway here or there. So for us, you know, whether you look at 342 overall in 2011 or our number 2014, being 347, they're right about the same. So for us, obviously, as we move forward, we want to figure out a way to improve this to reduce this number. That's obviously for us internally what one of our objectives will be.
You want to explain the UCR?
UCR is what we report to. It's official crime reporting, part one crime reporting. Your hierarchy, your highest crimes, obviously from homicide or murder all the way down to larceny or theft. That's what officially gets reported to the FBI. We do this on a monthly basis. So for us, the numbers, they are bona fide, they're forwarded, and they're official. So for us, it gives us a really good indication of where we are going. And we're flatlined across the 4 years. And I look internally at these numbers because I got to weigh violent crime versus property crime. And although we see a reduction in say, larceny, and that's good. We want to get that as low as we can. But I have some concerns about, say, the aggravated assault number, which is slightly up as opposed to years past. So we take a pretty strong look at that as we move forward to hopefully see a reduction in years to come. If I go on to the next slide. the arrest by type in June across the board, well, we're showing total arrest, we're showing that we were down in 2014, 844 versus in the first 2011 and 12, we were over 1,000, so we had an 11% decrease in total physical arrests. The drug arrests are down significantly, but obviously, as we know, we had the change in the law, and we moved over to citation. If you add citations, the number is rather consistent with years past. DUIs are slightly up at 13%. We've seen a significant increase in weapons violation. Weapons violations, and I can't underscore the importance of the assisted opening knives and the ordinance that was passed for us. That's part of the uptick in weapons violations and arrests. But I want to just point out that lower calls for service, lower arrests, and still seeing the overall benefits. I mean, that's the mix that we want to see. If I could go into the next. Next one. So alcohol citations by age, once again, significantly less. This year, total of 447 across the board from ages 17 to 25. If you look at 2013, we had 691. And if you go back on the next slide, 2011, 2012, we were over 1,000 and slightly under 1,000. So for us, that's also a pretty positive gauge that we are seeing less alcohol violations in June that we have had in years past, a pretty good indicator. I go forward again. As we move on to public safety in general, we look at traffic collisions. Traffic collisions were down under 100, first time this year in years past. The average is 134. For us, you know, a big move, positive movement in public safety, less traffic accidents, less injuries, less officers being committed to handling these, which are very taxing on our resources. This is a very positive indicator for us. Pedestrian collisions, although we were slightly up, we've really maintained the, if I could go one beyond that.
Okay. Councilmember Pills got a question on this one.
Yeah, can we go back to bikes? What do you think is the reason for that to be so? From previous years?
I think our campaign for roadway safety awareness, whether it's pedestrian, just more safety on the roadways, everything that we're doing, working with the State Highway Administration internally in the department, getting the message out. I think it really, we see the results here in June. And obviously, as we move forward, we're going to continue.
So there is 10 means there's more bike collisions, right?
Well, as we...
Am I misreading this?
Yes, ma'am. Oh. And we're going to move into bikes here in hopefully in a couple seconds.
Okay.
Pedestrian collisions are... in line, slightly up from last year, but obviously considerably less. So I think that what's important to realize is the gains that were realized last year continue on. And obviously that still remains a work in progress, which will lead me to the bicycle collisions. So for us, we saw a, now the year before we had zero in June, now we are looking at 10. So if you look at in relation to 11 and 12, slightly up from those years, but for us, we're taking a critical look at those, you know, the intersections involved and how they occurred and what the circumstances are. So obviously, as we move forward into next June, whatever we can put into place to send a message or help the cause, we certainly will do that. That's one of the reasons why we dissect these numbers to figure out how we're progressing.
Well, Chief, I have another question then. I mean, when does the department actually get these stats? Are you just getting June's stats?
No, ma'am. We've actually had these numbers. These numbers will come in actually throughout June, but the numbers as a whole, as they're finalized, will come in after June, so that we finally, you know, we'll get them throughout into July.
And my question is, do you have July's? Do you have August as well?
Yes.
You know what those answers are?
Yes, ma'am. Yep.
So then let me ask, before we get through the whole system, we're just looking at June. But why are at the end of the season, aren't we seeing the whole season, at least July and August and somewhat of September? If you already have these stats, why did you just show us a snapshot of June?
Well, this is just relegated to June. We're just going over the June report because in relation to the plan that was put in place to satisfy the strategic plan, this is strictly for June.
Okay.
But obviously we have those and we can talk about them.
Will we ever get a report of the whole season?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, and Chief, thank you. You hit it right on the head. Just wanted to make the distinction that one of the action items in our strategic plan was a June behavior report and then a follow-up action item. We certainly have that data available and can have further discussion, but the task today was to follow up on that action item from the strategic plan for the month of June.
Okay. I still don't understand that. June's pretty big on this slide here. I get it, but I'm just wondering why at the end of the season now, why the public now couldn't see what happened all season long. I mean, this picture's cleared for June.
They could.
But July.
And we can report on that. But the task today.
Well, can I get that report now? Can I get it not for here, but can you send it to Mayor and Council so we have that? Because I'd like to see a fuller picture with the season over.
Sure. In relation to bicycle.
Just what you'd hear, except for each month, July, August, and maybe whatever you have in September. Thank you, sir.
As I talked initially about our three. Points of regarding our philosophy, and the last one being professionalism is third, but certainly right equal to the others, is looking at internally, looking at departmental accidents in this category. We saw a drop off in departmental accidents. We had a 11 in 2013, a high in 2012. We were going in the wrong direction in 2014. We saw that number drop down rather significantly. And
go ahead, Councilmember Phillips.
The question I have is what changed
internally,
and what are the accidents? What are you referring to by collisions, departmental collisions?
Whether it's just an officer backing up into another vehicle, or
I want the public to know this is not serious, really serious things.
No.
I mean, it's minor fender benders and things like that.
Right.
Some of them.
Yes, most of them are.
What's
most
changed here from 2013 to 2014? That's great.
Well, we're our training, getting the word out, the significance, the seriousness of this. I mean, obviously, we're going in the wrong direction. We don't want this to fester. We want to get control of it. Mm-hmm. Whether it's an officer being injured or just as important, you know, a member of our public. So we kind of, you know, tightened things up a little bit, increased training. Looked at other models, other departments. We adopted some of their best practices. We instituted it for our department, and it's worked. We also keep a very, very critical eye on each one of these accidents and kind of dissect it right after it's happened, you know, so we don't kind of duplicate what we've been doing.
Chief, where you shine, you shine. Yep. This is great. I mean, this is really good.
Thank you.
Good results. Thank you.
And then I believe really the last slide just shows our furthers our departmental professionalism when we look at internal complaints, actually internal as well as external. When you look at internal complaints are within the agency, complaints officers lodge against other officers, and that would be supervisors against officers, as well as public complaints. And we've seen a significant decrease in those with four total, as opposed to an average being 11, about a two-thirds of the a drop-off in previous years. What does that tell us? It tells us that we're getting the job done and we're doing it in a very professional manner. So that's the second part of it. You know, it's one thing to reduce numbers and be more proficient and efficient in what we do, but also we cannot negate the fact that we got to do it in a professional manner, and it's obvious we are.
Yes.
All right, Councilmember Ashley.
Are you done, Chief?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, for me, I think, you know, the real issue here is really not the statistics, but did our residents and visitors feel safer in June this year? And all comments that I have, and I think most of us will agree, we did feel safer. Okay, so I think that your programs and your presence, the extra police, was very beneficial. And again, the issue is, did we feel safer? And I think we did. But I do have one question as far as June. Of course, June is usually high school, mostly high school age people. But I did notice, as you mentioned, the aggravated assaults are up 36%. And I think more importantly, those arrested in the 25-plus age range increased by 23%. And the weapons arrests were up 73%. Now, I'm wondering, what does that tell us?
I could tell you that what the figures bared out was the arrest by age are, the folks are, that are getting arrested in June in Ocean City are older than they traditionally have been. We're not seeing the arrests with persons 17, 18, 19. They're dropping, but we're looking at ages of 23 and 25. There's where we're seeing arrests. So not only just turning adult age, but several years in adult age. So that is why is that dynamic is changing. Are we getting, we have senior week in June, but we're, for the most part, we're getting folks that are a little older coming in, and that presents its series of challenges. And for us, weapons violations, yes, and that's one of the obvious reasons to change the ordinance, to get a control on what we're seeing, an uptick in persons carrying concealed items. And once again, I can't thank you enough for the assisted opening passing of the ordinance, which has given us a helping hand, because it's a matter of control and controlling, you know, behavior appropriately. So appreciate that. But for us, we're seeing some indicators that we have to look behind the numbers. And obviously, it's when we look at, you know, strategizing and where they're occurring and what times they're occurring and who is doing whatever they're doing, the behavior, and assessing that and planning ahead. So
yeah, on my travels, I've noticed an older type thug. Okay, which I think we have to keep an eye on, because I think they're here to prey on the younger people that are here. Okay, and this is certainly not what we want. So I hope you're keeping an eye on that, as you say, that type of demographic that is coming in and seems to be attracted here in June.
Yes. Yes, sir. Certainly.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. Mr. Mayor.
Well, I think both David and the chief touched on it, is that after the summer of 2013 and some of the incidents that occurred, particularly during the early month of June, we did in our strategic plan make it an action item for us to address that and put that onus on our police department. And Chief, I want to thank you and your department for the work they did preparing for June of 2014. And when it arrived, you were prepared, and it was very evident, and you had our police force out in force. They were visible. You recognized some of the trends that had been occurring and causing problems. I think Councilmember Ashley touched on one of them, and that's that there are older people down here during that time period taking advantage of some of those high school graduates, and you identified that. And I think it certainly shows in the arrests. The same with the weapons and the things that we see in other areas. They were starting to migrate here as well, and we became very, very much aware of that. And I think that you put together a very solid, effective, and efficient plan. I think the actions that you took in early June set the course for the rest of the summer, and I think we saw that. And I think not only were early June numbers, and as, again, Councilman Ashley referred to, the public saw it. They saw the police, they had confidence, they felt safe, and I think you did exactly what you set out to do early on. So as far as June goes and as far as this report, I know that you know, and you've told us, that's not a one-time deal, that if that's what we need to do in the beginning of the summer to set the course for the summer and set the direction, that's exactly what you're going to do. And I think we'll continue to do even better. We're faced with some new challenges now. And I know that as time goes on, you're going to be able to address some of those. We're always going to be faced with new challenges. But I think the way that we acted and what your department did in June of 2014 showed that you'll be up to those other challenges in the future, and you'll continue to do the job that's the best, I think, I've seen done in the Ocean City Police Department, which has always been a good department for a long time. Thank you.
Well, thank you, sir, and I appreciate that. I appreciate everyone's
support. All right, Councilmember Simak, right on down the line.
Just thought it would be interesting to make a point that in looking at the UCR crimes for June, that, you know, we look at this increase of 36%. But looking at the big picture, that is 4 over the average. If this was Baltimore City and we said 36%, we'd all be cringing. But yeah, it's 4 more aggravated assault cases.
Yeah,
but the point is, we're concerned about it.
But the chief said 4 is a big deal for us.
It is.
I don't think it's right to throw out the 39% or 36%.
Well, I'm just going by what was here.
I understand.
Okay.
This gives a false impression.
All right, Councilmember Pillows.
Yeah, we did get into, and I guess the public got it too, the graphs showing that the boardwalk, the slide of the boardwalk, and where some of the more
hotspots
are, I guess they're what they're called. When I looked at that, one thing I stood out to me was by 2014, at different times, it seems like at different areas, we were able to, you know, get control over the areas, but we never got control over a certain segment of the boardwalk, ever. Not one time did we see those numbers change. And it became very curious to me, without elaborating and talking about it, not having it in front of me, was how come we can't get control over that one section as well as we did the other sections? I don't know what's so different about that area.
You know, well, a couple things. One is just the populace, the popular concentration of people in that certain, that's the most popular area on the lower end of the boardwalk.
Right.
So you have to factor it as that population.
You're referring from 12th Street down, or is that what you're referring? I'm referring from 4 to 6.
Down on the lower, on the lower end as we move towards Division Street. You know, so we maintain that population. So what are the helping hands, not to go into too many of the tactics, but one is the cameras and really looking at the cameras as that additional resource for us to capture some of that activity. And I can tell you the truth behind the numbers. Some of those calls for service, although every call for service is important to us, but there's some general calls for service down there. You know, we look at what's driving it, you know, the significant malicious destruction, assaults, those disruptive types of behavior is the truth behind the calls for service. So you may still see an abundance of calls for there, but for lack of better words, they may be mundane calls or rudimentary type of calls that we're dealing with that we're going to face on a daily basis or day-to-day basis.
One of the things I thought about was 4 years ago or before 2011, perhaps there wasn't the combination of shops and restaurants in that area that there are now.
Right.
And that there's residential property, tourists, you know, hotels around that area that could contribute to that. I just don't understand why we can't get a handle on it.
Right, so. And it just goes back to, and I think we talked about it before when we talk about our population. Usually when population, you know, drops, you should see a decrease in crime or criminal events. Councilman Ashley, because we spoke about this previously, just talking about population decreases, and you should see decrease in crime. But as you see population increases too, you know, you also have that will bring its share of, you know, issues or increase our workload.
And so the second part to my concern is that I'd like to see what happened on the Bay side as a result of what happened on the boardwalk, because it is my, and we spoke about this earlier in the season, being on the Bay side there in that area, living there, I got calls from our neighborhood saying we're having a push from the boardwalk is coming to Edgewater, St. Louis. And so you didn't give us any stats on that because you were just in, and I understand why you're focused on the boardwalk, and I appreciate it. But when I do get this report, this other report that you're going to send me from June to September, I'd like to have the big picture of the town, especially from the boardwalk to the Bay side, from the inlet up to 17th Street or whatever, because it's important for us to see what's happening there as a result of what's happening on the boardwalk. So would you, David, could I please include that as part of it?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your help. By the way, things have improved.
Thank you.
And I don't want it to sound like for me that they haven't. It's just curious to find out why we are increasing and why in some areas we are not.
Sure.
Because I live directly in the area that it's not really, you know, getting better. So yes, thank you.
All right, Councilmember Dare.
Well, the report has a lot of interesting numbers, and I think we've gone through that. And what has just kind of struck me as amazing is a few years ago up here were debates about the worth of a crime analyst. And that's all we've talked about here, and that's what Councilmember Pillows has just asked for is a report. And I happen to know that the department works daily with the crime analysts and looking at these so that they can work smarter and more effectively, more efficiently. And today we're seeing those results are obviously paying off.
Thank you.
One of my better votes.
Thank you. Oh, got one more light coming on before you get off of here. Councilmember Ashley.
Just a personal observation, Chief. Of course, I'm at 9th in Philadelphia, and we had a building next to us, a seasonal building, where there was, in years past, constant problems. And I'd just like to compliment you, because your officers put that building on a rotation schedule and rode by there 2 or 3, 4 times a night to make sure everything was okay. So that was a major improvement in my neighborhood, and I thank you for that.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. David.
Thank you, Council President, Mayor, Council members, for all your feedback. Similarly, Chief, I'd like to echo a few of the mayor's remarks. But primarily, I'd like to point out for everyone, including the viewing public, that these trends, they didn't happen by happenstance. As was alluded to earlier, we had issues in June of 2013. Mayor and Council prioritized a June behavior plan. You identified it as a top priority in your strategic plan. The staff initiated and the Mayor and Council funded supplemental initiatives in anticipation of this summer, the additional cameras, security cameras on the boardwalk, the implementation and funding of City Watch program. But what I really would like to acknowledge and recognize is the special operations plan that the chief put together and coordinated for the college takeover, the event weekend, such that I told him in a staff meeting a week or so ago that he wrote the playbook, and other jurisdictions have taken note. If you were not aware, Chief Pizzurro recently attended a gathering of police chiefs in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where they have a bike-related event where last year resulted in 3 murders. The chief, along with other resort location police chiefs and law enforcement officials, met with Myrtle Beach to help them write the playbook. But what a success that was for Ocean City, and to know that, you know, our competitors, you know, who we like to compare ourselves to, are looking at us as the way of and how to do things. So hats off to you, hats off to the department. Great job.
Thank you,
Chief.
Thank you,
David.
And I would just like to finish off by saying, you know, I may be, you know, the face or the chief of the department, but really there's 104 fine men and women who stand behind me. They're very, very dedicated, loyal, and committed to getting this job done on a 24/7 basis, 7 days a week. And I just have to acknowledge all the hard work and effort that not only was done in June, but really is done every day, and especially as we move forward. And I'm just proud to be the part of such a great organization. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Well said.
Let me say one. Chief, before you leave, and Doug brought it up to me, and I know I touched on it, but you know, I want to thank you for this past weekend. I know it was challenging, and I know that you're reviewing exactly what occurred over this weekend, and you'll be getting back to us, and certainly wouldn't ask you for updates at this early hour. But again, I think our department showed their vigilance, and we're out there in full deployment along with some of our allied agencies, and I know they worked extremely hard to maintain the order in Ocean City, and they did a terrific job. It was a challenge. I know we're presented with some challenges, but I think what David just said and the way we reacted to June 2013 by what we did this year, I know we're going to employ some of those same tactics. So we look forward to continuing to work to resolve those issues.
Yes, sir, certainly.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Okay. All right, moving on. Next on our agenda is request approval of fund balance allocation to supplement street improvement funding level, presented by Public Works Director Mel Atkins. Now, welcome.
Good afternoon. I think I'm probably the next 4 items on your agenda.
Yes, you are.
And as we scroll through those, you'll see different representatives come to the table with me. Chalk it up to additional exposure on their behalf with the Mayor and City Council. Chalk it up to some succession planning within the department. So today with me on this topic is Woody Vickers, head of your construction department, which I know you've met once before, but he is one of the newest members of our staff. As I tried to detail in the template, during the FY15 budgeting process, We were unable to obtain the level of funding that we desired and was necessary for our current street improvement program. Historically, the Marin City Council over the last few years will be aware that we've discussed about doing a $3 million annual allocation. The last 2 years, we've included $1 million worth of that being considered St. Louis Avenue Phase 1 and 2. We're into Phase 3 at this time. So today's discussion is not revolving around $3 million. It's in fact revolving around $2 million. If you were to look at the notes provided in your agenda, roughly $1.3 million was allocated to our street improvement program as part of the FY15 budget. Before the council today, requesting consideration that you allocate $699,280 out of your unassigned fund balance that exceeds your 15% reserve policy. That will position us with a $2 million program, will allow Woody and the staff to continue moving forward with the street improvements that we have started as recently as about a week ago.
Okay. All right, now I think it's, go ahead, I got some lights. Councilmember Knight.
I'll make the motion that we take from our fund balance $699,280, which we will still be within the bounds of our reserve balance where we want to be for street paving.
All right. All right, a motion by Councilmember Knight.
I'll second with a question.
I have second by Councilmember Ashley. Go ahead, what's your question?
It says our unassigned and undesignated fund balance as of June 30th is $13,429,543. What is it as of today?
It's probably different than, it because it does fluctuate.
Well, I mean, is it much?
But that is the number based on our closeout for the last fiscal year. Martha probably has a better, can give you a better idea today.
Well, it's probably higher.
Well,
But not by very much. We haven't had that much. We've only had 3 months.
Okay, but it's not significantly lower than.
No.
Okay, all right.
No, we haven't done anything.
Okay.
Everything to date is as scheduled for the year with taxes and other receipts.
Okay, all right.
Council President, while I have the floor, I might add that this discussion is a follow-up and consistent with the discussion that we had during approval of the budget process, whereby we knew what we were allocating for street paving, and we knew that it was less than the targeted figure. But we also knew that we would come back to you and present available funding above that 15% policy following the closeout of the fiscal year. So this is consistent with the previous discussion that Mayor and Council have had regarding the fund.
Exactly. Councilmember Pulse.
So basically, it would have been, I think, it would have been better if we would have been able to see what the fund is today, because I think it reassures the public that there's probably more money. We're not that close to 15%. And so I would have liked to see, it's I know you pick these you say, you know, the closing of FY14's budget, but it's really clear. Sometimes you don't know. It could be, at this point, it could be lower. But you're using 15%. I mean, we could actually be at 14%. I mean, money could have been used. I don't know. But
Martha?
Because we don't know what to, how to think. I'm
Martha?
Sorry. Go ahead.
You're gonna
it takes
that.
Time to close out the year. Our auditors left on Friday.
Right.
However, last year, when you amended the budget, the final budget, you anticipated taking $2.3 million from fund balance.
Yeah.
The actual results for the year for FY14 for the general fund, $106,000 came. Our deficit for the year of spending was 106. That's $2.2 million better than was originally projected. So I don't, and this amount that is listed in his is very conservative amount. Because Mrs. Knapp went in and took out everything she could possibly think of, and I let her do it because amount that needs to be recalculated for TAB, the difference in the room tax receipts, amount you designated last year to paint and power wash City Hall. None of that's been done yet. But that's what we're going to do. And I said, fine, it's okay. And I said, and I don't have a problem with that. It still left you with $1.3 million available for appropriation above those amounts that she would come to you and say, well, TAB did not spend all their money last year. I think we have to give them another $58,000. According to the advertising formula, we need to increase advertising by $49,000. None of those things have occurred yet, and you have not approved those for done. But I did, I deducted those from this calculation because you typically
have done those changes after that. But this is very conservative number. Based on what you're going to see in the annual report, actually, is that over $2 million that's available for appropriation. But Mrs. Knapp didn't agree with me, and that's okay, because she was more conservative than me, and I said, fine, we still had $1.3 million.
Okay.
So I didn't debate a lot, but you couldn't have possibly, you haven't even done some of these things that have already been deducted.
Right.
Okay.
That's the explanation we needed. Thank you very much.
David?
And I'll tell you that the news only gets better, because Martha is working on an agenda item for an upcoming mayor and council meeting regarding our pension and OPEB contribution, which, as you all are aware, was considerably less than what we had figured. So, Councilmember Pillis, yeah, that is certainly going to affect the fund balance, and we'll have an updated figure at that time. So, Councilmember Ashley, that figure is moving
right
all the time. We chose the closeout at the end of the fiscal.
Let me tell you why I asked my question, because I'm for giving more money to the street. You see, I like the $3 million.
Yes,
I like the $3 million mark for the streets, as Hal knows. I've sat up here 8 years trying to get that money in place. But yeah, I was looking to say, if we have more funds, maybe we want to consider going back to that. But that's okay. It really was in light of giving more.
Anything else before we vote, Hal?
Not before you vote.
Okay. No. All right, Councilmember Dare's light on. So, I'm sorry.
Two things. First, you know, while this number is 90 days old, it's been rather, from a financial standpoint, uneventful 90 days. So I'm confident that those numbers are still good. On the other hand, had we had a hurricane visit town in August, we would have reduced revenue, mostly room tax, and we would have increased expenses in it. And then you'd have to question it whether we could make this appropriation. Second question is for Mr. Atkins. What are we, the budget you have prepared, I mean, the program that you've prepared for paving,
yes,
what is the number that you're going to be able to spend between now and Memorial Day?
Based on estimates between now and Memorial
Day,
$2,077,500.
Exactly.
And that's just an estimate, but that's all I can tell you today.
Okay.
So we're looking for another $77,000.
Not yet. Again, it's just an estimate, and as I work my way into the spring, I'll know where I'm
trying to get it for you.
Understood.
Work on that $77,000.
All right. I got a motion and a second to approve the fund balance allocation. All those in favor? The vote is unanimous.
Seizing the opportunity to put in a plug for the street paving program before we move to the next agenda item, I want the council to be aware of the following. A number of years ago, when casino revenues became available, you chose within your means to allocate them to your street improvement program. If you followed recent articles in the paper talking about the Horseshoe Casino coming online in Baltimore, the grant funding scenario where Worcester County would have been historically receiving 82% of the funds generated out of the casino here at Ocean Pines will now be converting to 100% of the funds. What does that mean? That means Worcester County will potentially be realizing an additional $500,000 annually. The current split is 60-20-10-10. 60% goes to the county, 20% goes to Ocean City, 10% to Berlin, and 10% to Ocean Pines. There is the opportunity in the future that you will be receiving on an annual basis roughly an additional $100,000 in casino revenues. I would like you just at that point, some point in the future, to consider directing that towards the street improvement program if possible. And I'm sure it will be in competition with many other issues. I completely understand that.
Yeah. Just like to put the plug in now, though.
You got it.
Yeah, got the ears on now.
Well, that's
Mr. Mayor.
That's been our policy, and if the funds increase, it should consider with that same policy and should remain consistent. And we have to state to the local development board how those funds are spent.
Yes.
And so far, that's where we've directed all those funds, and that has been approved by the local development board, who oversees the spending of those revenues. So looks like we'll remain consistent.
That would be greatly appreciated in the world of public works.
So it doesn't need a motion, he's saying.
Yeah. Councilmember Tressing?
Well, again, I would just caution everybody not to count their
chickens before they hatch. There also is gaming tables going in, and the county, if gaming tables go in, the county actually anticipates a loss in revenue.
Really?
So, just...
So, Nathan?
So you know.
On our end, thanks.
Because they actually, the county doesn't get any money from the gaming tables. They only get money from the video lottery type machines.
It's true.
Right.
All right.
Well, you'll straighten that out.
Thank you, Hal. All right. Next on the agenda is request approval of wastewater fund balance.
The next two issues, one is wastewater related, one is water, so Mr. Parsons will be joining me. The first issue deals with the wastewater department and the main electrical service and switchgear currently residing in the roadbed of Seabay Drive directly outside the treatment plant. Tagging off Councilman Dare's use of the word hurricane is rather appropriate, because what we faced during Hurricane Sandy was flooding of the area. If I recall, and I think Charlie is in the audience behind me, he can shake his head in disagreement or in agreement, but we were forced to turn the power off to the plant during that storm and rely on standby generation in fear that we were going to lose everything. Having commented on that, what we're proposing before you, the council, today is...
For the record, Charlie acknowledged you were correct.
I didn't even need to turn around.
I know you didn't, but
I
wanted the public who couldn't see Charlie shaking his head know that he did respond.
Before Hal even asked a question.
So we feel due diligence on our part is to move forward this time. It's a joint design effort between Delmarva Power and Light and Whitman Rec Art to relocate the electrical gear to a higher elevation further north on Seabay Drive and reconfigure the conduit runs and services coming into the plant. That is basically what is spelled out in your agenda. It's a $65,000 allocation to Delmarva Power and $150,000 allocation to Whitman. I will say the following, again, based on comments from Martha talking about performance on an annual basis of the budget, I would remind the council, I was before you on January 14th, 2014, requesting a fund balance allocation for over $402,000 so that Jim and I could move forward design of a secondary clarifier. We didn't have it in the budget. We had it in the wastewater's fund balance. You all approved it. We didn't need it. Charlie's end-of-the-year performance was he had nearly $300,000 less in expenditures, over $100,000 in additional revenue. So in one sense, I'm basically asking you to reappropriate funds you did last January.
Councilmember Knight.
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we make the allocation from the wastewater fund of $215,000.
Councilman Dare.
I'd like to second that motion with a comment.
Please.
Whether you believe in sea level rise or not, this is exactly what we're talking about on the Coast Smart Commission that I've been serving on in Annapolis, and that are looking at all the state facilities that are in floodplains, and they're coming up with what the mayor and council in the 1970s in Ocean City came up with, is, and that's raise your elevations higher than the what's been the minimums, and they want to know, well, how do you do that? Well, you do it one project at a time, and this project, probably that service was put in when the plant was built in the late 60s or whatever. So you know, everything that's been designed there, like the generator building, and that is addressed floodplain, and recently with the beach patrol we addressed it. And if you go by today and look at the fill that's been put in the pilings that are in, you can see what we need to do and how we are doing it and how we've been doing it for 40 years. So sea level rise.
Right. Never rise. We're anticipating one way or the other.
Councilman Phillips, your lights on.
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot what I was going to ask. Oh, yeah. Now, the motion is to remove the money. Where is it going? Where's the money being shifted to?
The money is, the motion is to withdraw that amount of money from the wastewater's fund balance. We will allocate it into a capital account for cost accounting purposes, right, and track it for the design.
Okay. Anybody else?
No.
Okay. No. We have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Dare to accept the recommendation from staff. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you, Al.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
The next project, let's talk H2O, but I'm not talking cars. I'm talking water. Should come no, it was no surprise to the Mayor and City Council in that I remind all of you, during the FY15 budgeting process, we originally had an allocation in there to blast and paint the 15th Street Water Tower. I remember stating that we were in the middle of a study and we weren't sure whether we were going to paint it or not, but if we didn't paint it, we had other things we were going to be reallocating that funding to. That issue was the design of a new water storage plant, tank, excuse me. The other thing I would remind the council on is that as part of your strategic planning initiatives, backsheet, major projects, 2014, right where I have my little arrow pointing, specifically states downtown water storage tank, and that is what we're here to discuss today. We are requesting permission to move forward with a design contract for a new 1 million gallon water storage tank located, proposed to be located on First Street and St. Louis Avenue. It would be the same configuration size as the one at 64th Street and at 94th Street. We have a 16-inch water main that is part of the St. Louis Avenue project that Dean is currently working on that is already funded, already designed, that is going into that property in anticipation of this tank. Funding allocation is not necessary. The funding is already there. It's already set up in its own account for tracking purposes. I will tell the council there are a number of issues that we will be resolving initially relative to some site planning issues, some cellular issues relative to the two tanks, one at Worcester and one at 15th, and some IT and radio communication issues. So should you be aware of other attachments that are currently on the tank at Worcester and 15th Street, those are all being addressed in the initial stages for this proposed project. It is our ultimate goal that when this is constructed, that the tank at Worcester Street and the tank at 15th Street will in fact be demolished, and you will have that land mass available for whatever improvements you may care to do at those two sites.
How many gallons is each one of those water tanks?
One is 500,000 gallons and the other is 400,000, total of 900,000. Yeah. And I was remiss on a comment that part of this analysis that we did back in December of 2013 was a hydraulic analysis on behalf of Fireflow. And in fact, this site proposed and the size proposed improves firefighting capability of Fireflows for the downtown area.
Okay. All right. I have a couple of lights on. Councilmember Dare?
Well, I'd like to make a motion that we authorize the staff to proceed with this project. It is very innovative. I think it's going to give us another 25 parking spaces down at the Worcester Street lot, and it also gives more parking space at the firehouse and future expansion should it be necessary. But what really impressed me is we can reduce the maintenance costs for the next 50 years in half. And in fact, it becomes almost cost neutral from that standpoint of building it. Those tanks have reached close to the end of their useful life. And even the style tank we use now is less costly to maintain because it doesn't have all the nooks and crannies that the older style does.
And Councilman Dare, I will add one of your comments that if you look at the I think it would be net gain of parking places at Worcester in comparison to the loss at First Street, you receive estimated net revenue increase of over $60,000 annually.
Oh, I'm sure.
In Worcester Street lot.
I don't think you mentioned it, but I suspect that having the one tank is going to help water quality as well.
It improves cycle issues on the tankage.
Right.
Okay. All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Dare. Councilmember Pills, your lights on.
Mr. McCaskey answered it for me, but I'll state it for the public anyway. It's the east.
You want a second?
Oh, second. Yeah, I second it. I'm
okay.
So sorry with the question.
I have a motion by Councilmember Dare and a second by Councilmember Pills. Go ahead.
Not here.
Go.
But anyway, I just wanted for the public to know this is where the little brick building is down there on the east side of St. Louis. And That's where the water tower is going to go.
Correct.
Correct? Right
there. It's known as the Second Street Sewage Pumping
Correct.
Station.
Correct.
Yes.
A sweet little building. Does that stay?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. It is a little building.
It is. Yeah. Oh, it's nice.
I'm I've only torn down one little brick building in my career. I'm not doing another one.
Good.
Talking about the monkey house?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, lesson learned.
I have a motion by Councilmember Dare and a second by Councilmember Pillows to approve staff recommendation. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. All right, Mr. Mayor.
Hal, a couple questions. Probably the timing's really good with this for any work you have to do on St. Louis Avenue that's involved with this project. Is that correct?
Correct.
So that's all built in there so that you're going to do that in advance as you move that south on St. Louis.
And any and all utility stub-ins, such as the 16-inch water main and some other issues, will be addressed by Dean as part of the Phase 3 project so that we are not having to disturb the road at a later date. You know, will the tank be built by next summer? No, the
no.
tank's not be built. But we're positioning ourselves not to dig the road back up.
And that was my next question. What would be the date of completion of the new tank and removal of the others?
Off the top of my head, moving forward tomorrow with Whitman Record on design issues, I would hope that we will resolve the design issues by March of 2015. Design issues such as IT, radio, cellular
right.
things, etc. We will go to bid by August of 2015. We could be in the position to construct this between September 2015, May of 2016. We would run it that summer, and I would position myself to tear down the other tankage in the fall of 2016. I do not desire to leave those two tanks in place like we did 66th Street for 10 years. There is no need for that.
We all agree with that. We Thank agreed you. With the other. Okay, I just wanted a timetable. And Terry was Hal pretty correct with the number of parking spaces and revenue? And also, that really squares off that parcel downtown. I mean, it really makes a big difference. You know, whatever we decide to do, if anything, on Worcester Street parking lot, it certainly makes it a lot easier and more practical to do without those facilities on that property. So I agree with Dennis, and I think for every reason everybody stated, this is a good idea and a good project, and thank you for bringing it forward.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next on the agenda is a discussion of rooftop tram advertising presented by Public Works Director.
Yep, if George could come forward on this one. As he's coming forward, I'll start the presentation, and that was, you will recall, and these are my words, not yours, that I rushed to try to get something on the boardwalk towards the end of last summer in an effort to test the market, both public perception-wise and potential advertiser-wise. In your agenda package, you have a couple color photos. If you didn't have the opportunity to actually see that one installation this summer, hopefully you've had an opportunity to view the panels, to view the drawings in your package. I've provided you with the cost. It's roughly $7,500 per coach installation. Definition of coach installation includes three signs. Two are rectangular and long. One is rectangular and small. Dealing with direct media, they're anticipating a minimum revenue source of $4,000 per month per coach. I'm looking for some directive from the Mayor and City Council, whether you wish to continue with this program, whether you wish for us to pursue outfitting the other 15 coaches, whether you wish for us to pursue removal of the one if you didn't like it for some reason. And the only reason I brought it forth now and not 30, 60, 90 days from now is that, you know, I'm not in the marketing business. You all deal much more with MGH or someone like that than I do. But direct media is leading us to believe that the buy time is approaching quickly for those for next summer, actually buying in the month of October. So I'm looking for some sort of directive from the Mayor and Council on what you'd like to do.
Okay. Councilmember Knight.
I have a question. And, of course, I did see the McDonald's sign up there. I saw it during the day. I saw it during the evening. What kind of response, and I got some response from some of the public I talked to, but did any of the tram engineers or conductors, what kind of response from the travelers on the trams, if any, did we receive?
I'll make a comment, and then George possibly has his own comments. I did go up there on purpose to view it. I did what I call standing on the outside of the fishbowl looking in. I'd lean by a planter and just listen to people to see what they'd have to say. And then I went and spoke to a couple of the tram drivers and conductors. Very few comments came back to me. I had a couple wows. I had one gentleman who actually said, anything to keep my taxes in line. And that's exactly what he did to me. I think over the whole time, I got one negative comment, like, okay, what's next? Meaning, okay, what are you going to sell next? George, you have comments, any from your own staff?
I did the same thing on various times. From the public, I got wows from all the employees, or most of the employees, they do not like it.
Can you, why?
They think it's too commercial. It's not the old Ocean City.
Okay, and
That was the employees now.
And that's the employees. And I would suspect the demographic of our tram conductors and drivers are probably at least 55 and over.
A lot of returnees. A lot of tram staff have been here for years.
Okay. Yep,
you are correct.
Okay.
You can even push your number up a little.
I didn't want to guess, but I was trying to guess on the conservative side. The impression I got and from the folks I talked was very similar, you know, anything to keep my taxes down. It didn't look to me obtrusive, so mine kind of went along with sure. Your.
All right, Mr. Mayor.
Well, I'm glad that you did get it up there so everybody could get an idea. And I think it was done correctly after a lot of work and a lot of time spent trying to figure out how to do it correctly. I thought it looked great. I think it's a great advertising opportunity, particularly for those people that have businesses downtown. I think I would certainly want to do that if I was them, not just on the boardwalk, but you know, some of those Bayside businesses like, you know, the Angler or the Marina Deck or some of Talbot Street Marina, some of those. You know, we always get questions. One of the most asked questions, I think, Joe, at the information booth is, where's the parasailing? Where do you rent jet skis? I mean, it's a great opportunity to lead people or let people know up on the boardwalk where some of these businesses are. But there isn't a more commercial area in town than the boardwalk. And the way these are done, if they're done under the same rules and regulations, which I know they will be, that we do bus advertising. What you didn't mention here is what the potential income is. Yeah. And I think that potential income after the space is paid for is about $125,000. That's a significant amount. Excuse me.
And that, I'm sorry for interrupting, that's based on the $4,000 minimum.
Right. And I think that that's a considerable amount of money and can be used for a lot of purposes, including paying the tram drivers. Maybe that'll let them know that. And reducing some of the other costs, but allowing us to do some things. And I think that the time has come to do that. I think it'll be well received. I think you'll have no trouble selling those, and I hope those businesses on the boardwalk, you know, I'd love to see if I had a business up there, follow me to the dough roller or something. You know, I think it's a great point of sale advertising. So I think it looked fine, and I think, you know, it'll blend in, and I think it'd be very productive.
Okay.
It's my opinion.
I got a bunch of lights on here. Councilmember Pills.
Well, I start out on the council voting against this. I think my last vote, I can't remember really, but I think I gave in to the income, the revenue of it. However, I think the bus drivers are a strong indication of not just their personal feelings, but they're hearing about the riders. And I hear more cons than pros. I'm in agreement with the bus with the employees. You know, I think people are saying, and I once, by the way, did an illustration in the newspaper because I'm a cartoon illustrator, in case people don't know this, political cartoon illustrator. But I did one of you, Mayor. But in any case.
You do all those cartoons in the last election?
No, oh. I didn't do that.
Okay.
Mine was done during one of the mayor's races. But in any case, you know, I think it is true. The cartoon I did was showing that, you know, we'll be putting signs on the benches and we'll be commercially selling our, you know, of course, the issue was the buses at the time. Selling the buses, and I even had a seagull coming down advertising, you know, saying, what's next? And that's the point I'm making. I mean, I think people come here to be here and to relax, too, and enjoy themselves. And I just think constantly, you know, giving them advertising over and over again. So I agree with the employees here, although I did vote for the revenue. So I hope we don't go any further than that and start giving the seagulls a sign. I hope we put a limit on something. But my other part of the question was, that was just a statement, but my other part of the question is, you're looking for national people to come in here too, so it won't just be the dough roller.
Well,
shenanigans or something on these buses?
If you were to vote to continue with the program or expand the program, and that's all you stated, then we will default back to what the current contract says with direct media. And it does not prohibit national. It doesn't hone it into specifically sales to boardwalk vendors only. It doesn't specifically zone it into within the corporate limits. So, yeah, I mean, Titleist could walk in here and say they wanted it. Ford could walk in here. Red Bull. I think the numbers could be a lot bigger, but that's just a personal opinion.
And then that's my point. Numbers get bigger, which means then the local people, it costs them much more to advertise again. It just keeps, you know, as you keep anteing up with bigger bucks, mm-hmm. you know, people can afford it, have a lot of different locations to be able to afford that number. It's inexpensive for them to advertise, but it becomes very expensive for the locals. So I think you're really shutting out the locals. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Councilman Matresi.
Well, I don't have a question, but I have a question about something that George said, and I'll wait till after the discussion of the signs goes by.
All right. Councilman Ashley.
Well, I remember specifically myself, I voted against this from the beginning, and I agree with the employees, too. I think it cheapens our brand. You know, I think it adds to the visual clutter of the boardwalk. I understand what the mayor is saying about the boardwalk being very commercial, but I think the tram itself stands out by itself by not being commercial. I think it more emphasizes our brand than having more visual clutter. So I would be against this.
Okay. All right, Councilmember Knight.
Well, I am definitely for it. As the mayor said, it is a commercial area. And with that said, because I don't think wrapping the buses, and as I recall, I was very new on the council mm-hmm. when we decided to wrap the buses, and that has been extremely successful. And I think it's kind of visually interesting when I'm on Coastal Highway to see, you know, Old Bay or to see Candy Kitchen, and visually I like it. So with that said, I'm going to make the motion that we accept the proposal to advertise on our tram and keep the media plan that we have, because I would like to see Old Bay, or I'd like to see Under Armour. Under Armour has a big presence in this area. So that's my motion.
All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Knight to approve the rooftop tram advertising on the trams and expand it. All right. Do I have a second?
I'll second it for discussion.
I have a second by Councilmember Matresi. Discussion, other discussion? Councilmember Dare.
I have to agree. I think it crosses a line. It just commercializes things more. And I think, in a way, we're being hypocritical when we tell the merchants on the boardwalk that they can't have A-frame signs out there, and then we put A-frame signs on top of the trams. I would have to agree with the revenue is attractive, but the last time we had a proposal for advertising on the trams and we authorized it, we fell way short of it. So while one out of 16 cars having a sign on it does stand out, I think when you put signage in all 16 of them, I don't know that it has the same wow effect and that you're going to be able to sell that many of them.
I look at the pictures that we were sent, nighttime pictures, and it does stand out very well. And I do think it gives the person on the boardwalk a chance to advertise, not in front of their business, but all over the boardwalk. And I don't see it being that unattractive. Like Mary said, at the same time, the buses, I think the buses are basically appealing now to people as they drive up and down the highway. You know, you see the Dunkin' Donuts bus or, you know, the whatever else bus, and it makes a big difference. You're also looking at $124,000 of revenue if you sell them all at $4,000. And I do believe what Hal has said is that that's a conservative figure for those banners when you open it up to all our advertisers out there, and they have time to sell these. So I do believe in doing this. I really do. I think it's something that it's basically attractive. It doesn't hurt the tram, sitting on the tram. So just my personal opinion. Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, just one comment, Dennis, is, you know, A-frame signs are in the public way. And during the season, it's very difficult. The boardwalk is crowded enough. And I think that's one of the reasons you don't have the A-frame signs. The side street businesses do have the opportunity to purchase signs on the poles if you recall, and that was granted to them in order to try to advertise their businesses. Those A-frame signs just take up a lot of room on the boardwalk. And, you know, if you wanted to do this, you could also designate that you wanted this to be open to local advertisers first, up until a certain date before they allowed it to be sent out to national advertisers. And that would give local businesses a first crack at the opportunity to rent those panels at the same price, so they're not in a price war with somebody else. So I think there's ways to do it. But, you know, we get down to budget time, $125,000 is a lot of money. And, you know, we're looking at other ways for sponsorships. And, you know, again, I believe everything's on a case-by-case basis, and I don't support signs on the benches or big signs on every pole or things like that. But I do believe in case-by-case basis. You know, we've talked about putting cars on the beach and all these different ways to get sponsorships to do stuff, and this is a way that, you know, looks pretty clean to me, and I think would be very effective for those that choose to do it. And I would hope if we open it up first to local businesses, they would fill them all before we turned it over and open it up to national businesses, if the council thought that would entice them to look favorably upon this. But I do support it. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Any other discussion? Okay. I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Trusick to move forward with the rooftop advertising. All those in favor? Vote is 3 in favor and those opposed?
With great reluctance, I'm going to vote.
With those opposed, is Councilmember Pillis, Simek, Ashley, and Dare. Motion dies.
No. I voted in favor.
Will you vote in favor? Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh.
I didn't see your hand.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what? I apologize.
Do you want to do it again?
Yeah. Okay. Let me announce the vote again. The vote is 4 in favor with 3 against. With 3 opposed are Councilmember Pillis, Dare, and Ashley. Okay. The motion passes. I didn't see your hand go up. I thought you were opposed. I apologize.
I was waving at you.
Yeah, you're waving. Councilmember Trusick.
George.
Yes, sir.
As somebody who follows the budget, I noticed that your budget for the tram in May was double what it's been in previous years. An explanation that I got was for training, yet you just sat here and told me today that all your drivers are returning. So how did we have all this training?
Not all the drivers returned. If I remember correctly, in my 11 years, this is the first year that we've had such a high rate of new employees, and I believe that was 40%. So you got 60% older ones, 40% new ones. You still have to train them. There's a lot of things that changed. There's a lot of refreshers that these people may need, and there's an awful lot of training for the new ones as far as the physical activity on the boardwalk, not just sitting in a classroom and telling them what to do. You have to put them out there.
Sure. Okay.
You've got two coaches that have live axles. They don't have a stationary axle and a live axle. They all are live axles. They react totally different from another piece of equipment.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Hal.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. All right. Next on our agenda, Patrice. We have a bid award recommendation for police and fire EMS uniforms. Should be presented by Patrice.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm not going to go through all the items, if that's okay.
We were looking forward to that.
There's 142 items, and I'm asking that they be awarded per the memo that was sent to council.
Okay. Councilmember Simek.
I would make a motion. We agree to award these as recommended.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
A motion by Councilmember Simek and a second by Councilmember Knight. Discussion, Councilmember Pills.
Yes, just for the public. They were in our package, so the public has the whole list anyway. I just didn't want them to think that they didn't have access to the list.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's a very good job. It's a lot of work. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. All right. All those in favor? Vote is all unanimous. Thank you. Couldn't see his hand either. All right. I got one more thing before we adjourn the meeting. I was handed a letter, and I need to read it. I told him I didn't want to take it, but it's already too late. It's from Councilmember Trusick. It says, Dear Council President, with this letter, I hereby submit my resignation as council member for the town of Vision City effective November 3rd, 2014 at 11:59 p.m. And this will allow my seat on the council to be filled for the next general election, thus saving the town the cost of a special election. Yeah, we'll miss you. All right, thank you. All right. All right. It is now official.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, and you need to do your duty here, sir?
Now get us out of here.
Motion to adjourn.
A motion by Councilmember Stresek. Councilmember Pillis?
I'll second.
A second by Councilmember Pillis. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Meeting adjourned. I don't know who's going to do that when you leave. Margaret?